Today's talk is about antibody mediated encephalitis, and mostly I would be restricting myself to NMDR encephalitis. So without wasting time, let's start. So my talk mostly would be unstructured because it is a very new thing which has come up and widely diagnosed these days. It has in 1960 the things have started. This is the legendary Dr. Porcelis photograph who is watching or seeing the coronal section of the brain sections of his patients. And subsequently in 1960, he published a paper in Brain describing subacute encephalitis of later adult life, mainly affecting the limbic area. Why it was important that before that, most of these subacute encephalitis patients either had syphilis or they were having subacute sclerosing pan encephalitis, named like something else before that, and those had inclusion bodies. They described three patients in which patient had subacute encephalitis with memory disturbances. Along with that, patient had psychiatric abnormalities and seizures. And their cut section post, once they died, their posthumously, their postpartum showed that they had intense inflammation in their limbic areas. And out of these three patients, one patient had associated malignant transformation of their mediastinal lymph node, which was remarkable. But at that time, the group said that it is remarkable, but probably it is not related to the disease process. So they were looking why this is happening and what is the etiological factor for all this. And these are the slides from the same very paper, which has shown intense inflammatory markers along with that structural destruction of the hippocampal area. I am having some echo. So subsequently, this very same group, first time described it as a limbic encephalitis, and they showed that it is associated with carcinomas. The paper was published in 1968 by the same very group. Unmindful that during that very same decade, in 1965, Wilkinson's and colleagues had already described immunofluorescent detection of antibodies against neurons in sensory carcinomatous neuropathy in that very same journal. So these three landmark papers ultimately led to the discovery of what we know today as paraneoplastic syndrome. Again, an antibody mediated encephalopathy and the encephalitis, but the antigen is basically intracellular. And this is basically a diagrammatical representation what they were seeing. That is, patient is having encephalitis, which was associated with the antigens, which were intracellular. And since the antibodies were unable to go inside the cells, there was intense cytotoxic T cell response, which led to the destruction of the cells and probably the non-recovery of these species. Subsequently, over the period of time, in last particularly 1.5 decade, we have come across certain antibodies which are on the cell surface, that is extracellular, and they also cause similar kind of encephalitis with memory disturbances, psychiatric symptoms, and plus minus seizures. And this is important because these kind of encephalitis are treatable with the present armamentarium which we have. What happens during this or how this is triggered is basically the trigger factors lead to presentation of antigens to the dendritic cells and subsequently formation of from the naive B cells, formation of memory B cells and plasma cells, leading to formation of antibodies which are systemic in nature and subsequently attack the brain cell antigens, and the different type of antigens giving rise to different type of blockages or changes in the receptor body. The most commonly studied is NMDR, in which there is an internalization of the receptors and the receptors are unable to work and the plasticity of the receptors is reduced. And in cases of GABA, there is a functional blocking of the target antigen leading to blocking of receptor signaling. In second most studied LG1 antibodies, there is a disruption of the protein-protein interaction. So, over the decade, over the period of from 1960, what has happened is that I have demarcated the time period once these antibodies were discovered. Initial years all went into the discovery of paraneoplastic antibodies, that is the antibodies which were intracellular. And this is the time period, exciting times in the neurology from 2004 to 2007, during which there was discovery of NMDR, and subsequently there was discovery of lot number of surface or extracellular antibodies, which led to the discovery of treatment protocol also in these patients. So since 2005, nearly more than 16 antibodies have been described, and out of these, the commonly studied and commonly what they have found commonly in patients is NMDR, and second most common is a VGKCC related, that is leucine-rich glioma inactivated 1 antibody. And they are present with different kind of scenarios, and I will discuss all those later. So 2005 was the watershed paradigm shift in the neurology of autoimmune disorders. Before that, as we know, there were antibodies, but there was discovery of antibodies, but they were all disorders which were probably not amenable to the treatment and mostly associated with the carcinoma. So first time in 2005, Dr. Joseph Dalmo and colleague described 4 patients, those who had similar kind of presentation, but were associated with ovarian teratoma. And with subsequent paper in which they have published 12 similar kind of patients with different kind of presentation, they all had ovarian teratoma. Mostly they have ovarian teratoma associated, and they labeled initially it as paraneoplastic anti-N-methyl-D-aspartate receptor encephalitis, which is probably amenable to treatment, although the treatment requires protracted course. So in these 12 patients, what they found over the period of time was that most of these patients had headache, they had short-term memory loss, they had hyperthermia and seizures. And most of these patients had partial seizures, they had generalized tonic-clonic seizures, and few of them even had refractory status epilepticus. The catatonia was present, a fluctuating kind, and patient had myoclonic and dyskinetic movements in face and arm, and they had autonomic instability. What they actually didn't have was the systemic involvement except for autonomic instability. So this is important. So this is a landmark paper which has, with a cohort of more than 577 patients, they have delineated what is the presence of this antibody, what is the gender and tumor association with anti-NMDR encephalite. It was published in 2013. If you look closely at the diagram, this from patients age 12 to 40, most of these patients fall into this age group. And blue, dark blue and light blue are the pictures showing are representative of the male with and without tumor. So most of these patients fell into this age category, and most of these patients were females. And nearly 50% of these female patients had an associated tumor, that is teratoma, which was found. Subsequently, post this, that is more than 40 years also, it was present, but rarely, and it was occasionally also associated with a teratoma or a tumor. The differentiating feature is that this anti-NMDR encephalitis was seen in early age group also, that is patients less than 12 years of age. The prevalence amongst different gender was equal, and rarely a tumor was associated with that. So this picture actually shows the comprehensive study of 577 patients shows that mostly this affects the female, and nearly in the middle and the young age group, and out of those nearly 50% of the patients would have associated tumor. And in younger age group, there is not much of difference between male and females, and they are rarely associated with tumor at that age group. So what are the symptom development and time course of anti-NMDR receptor antibody encephalite? So this is a beautiful picture by Kaiser and et al. Published in 2011, in which they have subdivided these stages into 4 groups. First is the viral prodrome, that is minor headaches, fever, patient having myalgia, minor chest symptoms, mostly ignored initially. And subsequently, the second stage was having florid psychiatric symptoms, including hallucinations, mania, speech disturbances, memory deficit, and occasionally patient would have seizures also at that period of time. Once this is not treated, patient goes into the third stage that lasts nearly weeks to months. And in this case, patient mostly goes into the coma, and ultimately they are intubated and they are in the intensive care unit. This phase is marked by dyskinesias, catatonia, patient can be having dissociative reactions, autonomic dysregulation, and hypoventilation. So due to these, patient could ultimately land up in ICU and then on a ventilator. This phase, if treated, subsequently leads to prolonged recovery phase that lasts nearly for next 2 years. And in those, even after recovery, patient would still have some executive dysfunctions, impulsivity, disinhibition, and memory, mostly frontal lobe involvements. So why this symptomatology is important for any physician who is in direct contact with, who is indirectly seeing these younger age group patients with psychiatric symptoms. So this first prodrome phase is mostly missed. Patients don't come to the hospital or to the treating doctor. So what we see is actually patient coming in a with a florid psychiatric symptoms. And yes, they obviously would land up with a psychiatrist. Nearly 75% of the patient would go to a psychiatrist first. And so once you land up with a psychiatric clinic with a florid psychiatric symptoms, would be given an antipsychotic drug. What happens? You have received an antipsychotic drug in first 1 to 4 weeks, and obviously this is not going to make the difference to the patient's symptoms. So patient will go into the third stage, will develop coma, will develop catatonic features, hypoventilation, autonomic dysregulation, and he would be misdiagnosed as neuroleptic malignant syndrome due to antipsychotic. So this diagram or this stage progression of this disease is important. Young females coming to us in our OPD settings with florid psychotic symptoms initially should be very cautious. It may ultimately turn out to be a case of autoimmune encephalitis, particularly NMDR encephalitis. What triggers the anti-NMDR encephalitis? As of today, we know there are two triggers which have been delineated over the period of time and a number of papers have come through. First is the teratoma. Nearly 50% of the patient has. I have already shown the slides. And teratoma is a monstrous tumor having different cell lineage. And out of that, patient would have obviously a neuron cell lineage also expressing NMDR and antigen. To that NMDR antigen, obviously, ultimately, an antibody would be formed, and subsequently it would reach the brain through the blood, breach the choroid plexus, and then attack the NMDA receptor inside the brain, leading to the disease. Similarly, in cases of herpes encephalitis, now it has been proven that local destruction of the brain area would eventually lead to presentation of the antigen cells to the naive B cells with the antigen presenting cells, ultimately with the formation of plasma cells and B cells, leading to similar kind of presentation. So, which is the subtype of area which is involved in NMDR encephalitis? The antibodies are mostly formed against the GLUT1 subtype. So, how to diagnose? First is suspicion. Then, obviously, there are different armamentarium in the field of neurology, which we obviously employ over the period of time. So most of these patients, those who have these kind of diseases, first is lumbar puncture. Is it diagnostic? Yeah, it could be. If we are suspicious that patient is having anti-NMDR encephalitis or autoimmune encephalitis, then we do a panel and ultimately it turns out to be an anti-NMDR positive. Otherwise, a routine biochemistry of the CSF would show only pleocytosis, lymphocytic pleocytosis, mildly elevated protein with normal glucose, which can obviously can be a presentation of a viral encephalitis also. So what next? IgE index would be elevated. Just it's an indicator that is intrathecal antibody synthesis, again not diagnostic, and 50% of these patients would have polyglutamine bands also. So next armamentarium is obviously EEG, although what has been observed that more than 80 to 85% of the patients would develop seizures, those who are suffering with autoimmune encephalitis, but most of them will not have a electrophysiological evidence of seizure activity. This is a paper which by Kim et al. In 2012, which has shown a characteristic feature which can be seen in a certain group of patients of autoimmune encephalitis, NMDR. Which can give a clue that this is probably an NMDR encephalitis. What they have seen is that for 23 consecutive patients of anti-NMDR encephalitis, proven ones, that nearly 90% of the EEG is abnormal, but not diagnostic. That means they have some abnormality like focal slowing, generalized slowing, and other things, sometimes focal seizure activity also, but they are not diagnostic for this thing. that can be seen in all other disorders which can cause encephalitis. So what they saw was 30% of these patients had extreme delta brush, that is a background of delta activity superimposed by 20 to 30 hertz beta activity, a similar kind of activity which is being seen in neonatal group of patients, in which it is called as delta brush or what we call as beta delta activity. In these, they have seen a delta activity superimposed by a characteristic high frequency beta activity called as extreme delta brush. So this can lead to a suspicion that this patient might be suffering with autoimmune encephalitis, that NMDA receptor encephalitis. A subsequent paper published in a Chinese cohort showed similar kind of result with a little less number of patients having this kind of extreme delta activity. A cohort of 52 patients, abnormal 98, non-diagnostic, extreme delta brush only 16 patients. So what happens, or is MR diagnostic in these patients? So four set of abnormalities can be seen in these patients. So this is a paper by Zhang et al. In Academy of Journal of Neuroradiology, American Journal of Neuroradiology, in which they have shown four patterns of abnormality which can be seen in these patients. One is normal, that is nearly 50% of these patients, more than 50 to 60% of these patients would be having a normal MRI. A few would be having an isolated hippocampal area or limbic area involvement. This is second variety. Third would be normal hippocampal with abnormalities or hyperintensity in the front, in the lobar area, as well as in the cerebellar peduncle or brainstem. And the fourth variety would be in which both hippocampal would be involved as well as the lobar area would be involved. So the thing to see here is that nearly 60 to 70% of the patients would be having initial normal MRI. So a normal MRI in a suspected case of NMDR encephalitis cannot rule out NMDR encephalitis, not diagnostic. These are the different findings I would like to do because of paucity of time. Does FDG PET CT score over the MRI? Yes, in some sense, in that a normal MRI brain in a patient of NMDR encephalitis would still be having an abnormal FDG PET scan. But the abnormalities which are present are again non-specific. That can happen in another disorder. This patient can have hypometabolism in cortical, subcortical areas. In some cases, predominantly with the gradient of anterior to posterior, but again, it is not pathognomic of NMDR encephalitis. So yes, if patient's MR is normal, you can go ahead with the PET scan, look for his brain activity, FDG PET uptake. If it is abnormal, that shows actually something is happening inside the brain. Plus, you can do a whole body PET to look for evidence of any tumor. So how to diagnose or how to diagnose? So many people have gone through all these things to look for whether there is some clinical hints that this patient can be diagnosed. Ultimately, none found any set of pattern which, if we employ, would say that this set of patient would be NMDR encephalitis and these would be probably other parts. So nothing has happened. So they have come up with the diagnostic criteria. This was 2016 and probably it is up for an update. So there is something which don't gel with the present awareness and the knowledge we have from the different papers which have been published. So this, if you remember the previous slide in which I showed the stages of the disease, this is nothing but the same, in which a probable diagnosis means a rapid onset, less than 3 months, and out of six major symptoms, patient would be having four. And what are these six major symptoms? Weak left, stage second, and stage third. Stage second, patient having florid psychiatric symptoms, speech disturbances, and seizures. Stage third, patient having movement disorders, decreased level of consciousness, hypoventilation, and autonomic dysfunction. So out of these two, stage two, stage three, if patient is having four symptoms and is having a rapid onset, plus an abnormal EEG or an abnormal CSF, we can label this patient as a case of probable NMDR encephalitis after excluding what we call as a previous history of herpes simplex encephalitis and Japanese B encephalitis. But these papers that the herpes simplex encephalitis is probably a trigger factor for that has come recently in last 2-3 years, and this paper is up to 2. Probably this is going to get upgraded over a period of time. And in case of definitive, obviously you have to show the presence of antibodies against GLU-1 antibodies in the CSF. And in cases of even if you do it in serum, you have to again reinforce with a live neuron or tissue immunohistochemistry to prove it, that it is basically affecting the brain. Again, they have shown the exclusion criteria, same heart tissue simplex and Japanese encephalitis, which probably shown to change. This is Dr. Joseph Dalmo had given a mnemonic. It's nothing but same different kind of presentation which can be seen in with a rapid diagnosis. And two things are more important: the rule out neuroleptic malignant syndrome and antipsychotic intolerance. So coming to the treatment of these patients, there is a cohort of more than 500 patients in which they have studied what will work and what will not. So first line immune therapy which has been tried is steroid, IVIG and PLEX, both alone as well in combination. Second line would be rituximab and cyclophosphamide, again alone in combination. Treatment failure if no improvement occurs at 4 weeks or the score of MRS remain more than 4. And relapse encephalitis if patient gets new symptoms or there is worsening of symptoms after initial recovery. So what they have seen, I would just summarize that in this case, a first failure of the first line immunotherapy is at a daunting 50%. So 50% of these patients won't respond to the first immunotherapy. So don't get disheartened if you see these patients. Try the second one. And probably more than 81% of out of these cohort eventually recovered over the period of more than 24 months. So these are the different drugs. I would just like to highlight this one, that patient, those who have steroid saving agents for maintaining therapy, only if their steroid led to clinical improvement. So mycophenolate, azathioprine can be tried in these patients. And in cases, second line drug also failing, you use teclizumab or low dose interleukin. The other thing which you have to do is that if patient has a teratoma, you have to operate. What is the newer thing which has come or probably is going to come is a positive allosteric modulation. It is basically nothing but a molecule which will alter the receptor morphology and probably restore the receptor morphology so that it works normally again, which has been disrupted by the antibody. So in this paper, they have used oxysterone as a broad spectrum positive allosteric modulation and showed conclusively in any model that it can achieve the desired results. And if it can be shifted from the lab to the clinical bedside, probably we will see a time period when these kinds of diseases would be treated in conjunction with the previous drugs in a faster manner. So while summarizing, I would suggest it's a new disease, although extensively studied over the period of last 20 years, and these are antibodies are mediated against extracellular proteins. They basically cause structural and functional changes, no major destruction of the neurons. So there is a better prognosis. So it's better to pick these patients early and treat early. So any young female coming with initial florid psychiatric symptoms with no systemic feature except autonomic dysfunction, abnormal CSF, plus minus delta brush, plus minus deterioration with antipsychotic or NMS, always, always look for autoimmune process and any evidence of ovarian teratoma. Probably we will see more. Thank you.